Islam. Salam alaikum, alhamdulillah, mashallah. What's up, folks? Shout out to everybody that's keeping Torah and living an Islamic life. Shout out to all of you. Hope everybody is well this morning. What is woke? What is woke, y'all? I believe this song came out in like the 70s. Wake up, everybody. In 1977, I was 10 years old, y'all. They was talking about wake up back then. Teachers, teach a new way. I'm reading. 1975. I was 8. I'm 55 now. Well, will be in December, so I claim it. The doctors. I reserve all rights. All the music that I play, I do own. I pay for a monthly Spotify streaming service. If anybody's cheating or defrauding anyone, it's Spotify, because they're selling it. Not us. We gotta change it. It's 2022. Need some help, y'all. Been saying it, right? Need some help, y'all. Need a little help. Change the world. Who was he talking about to do it? Voting, like in the 70s. He wasn't asking for the government to do shit. He was talking to people. Some old school, new school. I do teach a new way, if you want to call it teaching. I teach the truth, is exactly what I teach. The truth. This is in 75. He's calling for people to teach a new way. You're not asking the government to do shit. Dope dealers, dope users. Stop. Pretty simple. Not intricate. False preaching. False teachings. Wake up, y'all. What's woke? Seventy-five. What's a politician? What's their job? What's the gross national product of politicians? Saying this in 75, like I'm gonna turn it off right now, y'all. Again, Islam, Salam Alaikum, Alhamdulillah, Mashallah, Shabbat Shalom. Greetings and whatever your dialect is. I appreciate everybody for coming through. Let me start off by shouting out the regular folk that come through all the time. I do appreciate y'all, because in this world, man, it's a lot of folk that are into a lot of things that are fruitless. So I appreciate y'all taking the time at least to listen. So let me shout out the regular family that come through on the regular. Little brother Brennan, Big Worm, Sister Tina Dalton, Callie 916 Aries, my brother Kane, what's up, bro? Sis Miss Copper Squad, how you doing? Big Vanny Lyles, little brother Gab, my sister Jackie Brown, OGP, Preston Evans, Isarelli, DJ Tarzan, little sister Bree, Cicelo, my son, who I see is active now. What's up, Kaylin? Sister Miriam Ali, Anil Matthews, Sister Jessica Martin, my sister Rosa Pereira. I hope I said that right, Rosa. Nephew Rel, which is Jay Blessed on here. What's good? Appreciate you all stopping through daily. If I missed anybody, holler at me in the comments. If you don't like the broadcast, that's natural. Like, most people don't like everything, so I might not be your cup of tea. Don't be childish and leave a comment. Don't go out your way to say, I don't like you. Not personally, like for me, it won't make a difference. But for you, it'll show who your character is. You could be that bothered by somebody that I'm quite sure on your end, you'll be like, this nigga don't matter in my life. But the comment actually say something else. This is the reality of being woke for real. Like not being a victim, not being pulled into something that's really not there, right? So I came across another audio, actually it's a video, but you guys will just hear the audio from the elder Thomas Sowell. And Thomas Sowell, I believe, is in his 80s, 80 years old, so, and he would be what you call black, right? So if anybody's not familiar, please get familiar with Uncle Thomas Sowell. Those are the audio links you hear when I play about black culture, where it came from. So I learned all of that stuff from Thomas Sowell. Learned it from him. Didn't know it myself. Was ignorant of all these facts. So shout out to that elder. Which is more incredible, which is more proof the blacks are bullshit when they say stuff. Yesterday I had the honor and dishonor of meeting a old black fool and an old white fool yesterday, right? On two different spectrums. I was at the park yesterday getting my calisthenic workout on, and I was leaving and I saw a guy I used to play with. Shout out to Kenny. Kenny is about 51. Like I said, I'll be 55 in December. So we played basketball our whole life. Kenny is still in decent shape, not calisthenic workout shape, but for a regular day-to-day guy, decent shape. And he was talking to some guy. So I went and spoke to Kenny. And the guy was there and I spoke. Me and Kenny started talking about our shape at our age. And then this guy was like, I'm 61, like proudly. He's 61. And I'm looking at him like, he didn't look remarkable to be 61. And then since he was proudly 61, I was like, yeah, your generation, the generation kind of before me, y'all got us where we are today. So, you know, I started opening that can of worms of accountability. And in true fashion, like every effeminate man, every man that's not accountable, we like, they tricked us, you know, or we didn't know, they didn't know. And I started to go in, but I was like, you a part of it. I just kept telling them, you a part of it. You did it. Your generation did it. That's it. And it wasn't a threatening situation because he was an old man. And I'm not out to be threatening physically or even insinuate violence. But I talk the way I talk. I'm not going to change the way I talk. And I'm not moved or I'm not afraid if a man talks like a man. Like, I know who I am as a man. I'm not worried about a quick draw or anything like that. I move with Allah. So if that be it, then that be it. You dig what I'm saying? Then that be it. So I can't talk any other way, but war is war with me. Like, either we at war, we at peace. Talking ain't war, it's talking. You know, lions roar. He not gonna whisper, you know, and I'm not saying anything about me being the king of the jungle. It's just my communication is mine. You need to understand that. I'm not gonna dumb it down to make you comfortable. The world won't do that. They'll keep telling you to dumb down to make somebody else comfortable that don't deserve it. And this is the whole curse of it. This guy, this older black guy in the 60s don't get it. That Thomas Sowell is out here. He's older than him. And I'm going to let you hear what this elder had to say. And it kind of covers the black guy. I haven't spoken about the white guy. The white guy is the standard liberal. He lives around here, and I actually smoked with him. You know, older guys in the 70s, 72, he said. Name is Joe, walks his dog daily, where I live at. And we had passing conversation, and he's a one-way conversationalist, right? And I'm compassionate about stuff like that. I understand who I am, where I am, and where people are. And I give passes up to certain extents. Yesterday, Joe's pass got revoked. And it came down to the passive aggressiveness about America and what America's responsibility was to the rest of the world. And he had that whole idea like, oh, you're accountable to somebody else, blah, blah, blah. I was like, if I whipped your ass, if I jumped on you right now, who in China would give a fuck? So I had to make it real for him. And I was threatening. He's an older man. And he was talking about, well, it's your job as Americans to blah, blah, blah. It's like, my kids live here. I don't give a fuck about anywhere else. So I turned up on him like that. He's 70-something. Like, if I jumped on your ass right now, you think anybody in China would give a fuck? And his eyebrows raised. I'm like, yeah, like, don't pitch some speech to me, some age-old speech. If it's anything that's racism, that's it. Because now you assuming that you know what's best for me because it's best for you. Like, I told him I don't pay taxes to drive with a license. He was like, well, blah, blah, something about, you know, the whole stick about everybody else. And I was like, I don't give a fuck about you, Joe. Like, you know where you live at? Your area that you walk in? Why don't you get some concrete mortar and brick and build a walkway from here to there and your neighbor do the same? Then you don't worry about the government. He wanted roads paved and he wanted mail. That was his concern why he didn't mind paying taxes. I was like, well, I don't want mail. I don't get mail. And I don't need roads paved. They make four-wheel drive vehicles. Shout out to all my rednecks with paychecks, brothers. That's Mudbog and Redneck Yacht Club. They drive trucks through stuff that was stop boats. You know what I mean? So North Sentinel Island, the whole 9 yards, but I didn't go through all of that with him. When people start doing shit like that, I go for the jugular vein, you know? So that's what I did with him. I made it real. I made my presence felt where he was at. So all that talk changed. Then it was like, okay, have a nice day. Yeah, it is have a nice day when you approach people with actual facts and don't allow their emotions or their lies or stuff that they can't prove to rule a day. So we got this one white fool on this end to think that you should be told what to do or you should do this because he wants a certain thing. Like, that's not what America is about. And if you don't understand that, you need to get the fuck out of America. It's not about me. It's not about you. It's about us. And if what I want don't stop your life from bubbling, then why the fuck are you worried about it? Either way. Now, I keep the word of our creator, which is something more than this country is holding y'all motherfuckers to. You dig what I'm saying? Y'all out here petitioning about your right to get married if you're the same sex. Like, that's really a problem in society. Mankind will cease to exist if you guys are not allowed to bromance it up. Man, stop with the fuckery. Nobody listen to that shit. That's all emotional. What I just did, I got my pleats, right? My non-commercial, not-for-hire place. That's in real time. But blacks especially trying to act like, oh, that's your thing. My thing is no money involved with it. It's a freedom thing. So when y'all talk about they didn't know, I'm like, well, what about right now when I'm the first people that I presented this with that would benefit from it more than anybody else was the black people. The first people told me to kiss their ass was the black people, right? Still, it's still on the table. So all this shit about you was fooled, you didn't know, You don't want to know. You conveniently stay stupid. So you can tell a lie that you don't know, but it's gotta be a way to show that you lying. You looking at them. You might not want to accept it, but you can't get rid of it. You can't erase what I did. You can't erase what I'm doing. You can't unsee it. I'm right here doing it right now in real time. That's me. Look, hey, it's not magic. That's a real person on the screen. Everything that I said, I accomplished. And these people that call themselves black keep making up these lies, right? And the white part, we talking black and white in terms that y'all are not going to understand. The white part is non-existence in my life because what y'all consider systemic and oppressive, I have jumped right out of that. And they have no say in my life. You don't because you want what's there, monetary, you are afraid to stand up to them for which you might lose. That's the beginning and end of it. So you deflect and say, you don't know. You only cannot know for so long, Jack. You know what I'm saying? Like, you dishonest to say that shit. And for anybody to saying that they didn't know, the fuck you mean they didn't know? You don't know. You know, that's a clever way of trying to cop out. You don't fucking know. Anybody that's saying, oh, they didn't know as an excuse, motherfucker, you still don't know. You still don't know. If you still got that state-based ID, a driver's license, and you paying taxes, you still don't know. You might feel a way about it or think you might. You don't know. You don't know. There's nothing you can say in contrast or contrary to what I've shown. You can get in your emotions and not want it to be true and do what women do and just argue because you got a mouth. Go ahead. You ain't going to change one video that I dropped. You're not going to change that license plate that I have on my car that I put forth. Like, I got that. The state will never give you one to say non-commercial, not for hire. Why would they do that? If you ask the state, are they in control of you? Judge Nicholas Trabasi said in the courtroom that the state absolutely has jurisdiction over me. That's what a sitting judge said in Towson. Nobody, Black Lives Matter, NAACP, nobody attacked that guy. He shouldn't be there. He shouldn't be sitting there, but it didn't hurt their organization or their money. It's just the independent me. Same thing with any fucking organizations. That is the issue. Organizations are not there for the people. They're there for themselves. It's a money grab. I keep saying, Allah don't need a building. Once that building goes up, it's a structure that's going to deal with other buildings, and it's going to be made deals. It's going to be confederacies from this landmass to that landmass to this one to that one till it's a United States of Commerce. To how they going to deal with each other. The Penns and the Calverts and the other nobles, the other families that brought into this, the other royal lines that came here. How are we going to govern ourselves amongst each other? After they took it under Christianity, they decided to govern under Christianity. But everybody's Christianity wasn't the same. The Protestants and the Catholics were at it. You had all kinds of different Christian denominations here. So it has to be one land, ambiguous, generically under God, like they originally intended it to be. So when you go into court, you don't get Protestant justice. You don't get Catholic justice. You don't get Mormon justice. You get the justice of God. The one thing, the equitable thing that's past Chinese, blacks, it's the justice that all men and women get. And if you keep giving that justice, that right to govern to a man, then you'll be governed by that man. And he'll come out the gate and pretend like your birth certificate, social security card, all these things. Like, oh yeah, in order for you to exist, you got to fill these things out. Stop filling them out. See if you disappear. The state set up a situation that's going to be uncomfortable for you once you're in it. You catch that when your child don't owe this world anything and you correct it there. Everybody that's in the system, it's going to have to be a tragic event like with me to pull me all the way out of it. And that's not a pass. I'm saying to you people that's still in it, understand you in it. Stop being ashamed of yourself or ashamed of your stupidity. Own up to it. Feel ashamed of it in a way that you're going to fix it. Don't counter or try to say, oh, I know this or I know that. If y'all can explain the shit, you should be able to change the shit. So stop making up fucking excuses. These kids don't deserve that shit. It's no other groups of kids that fail like black kids fail. And it's because of the elders. It's because of this attitude that, or they tricked them. A 61-year-old man, excuse me, yesterday at Drew Hill Park, saying they didn't know. You old motherfucker, you don't know. And then I told him, like, you don't know right now. Look at my license plate. Do you know that? They don't want to hear it because they just don't want to hear it. I know more than you. I know more than probably most black people. You know what I'm saying? I know more than the majority of black people. They were like, oh, no, you don't. I got this degree, that degree, that degree. You can wipe your ass with what you know with that degree. That's going to get you a job. So as long as you got a job, you don't have to be free. Then we call that slavery. You trading off something, right? You getting a bag. Cool. What did Allah say about a bag? Where's the bag mentioned as divine? So y'all want to dip in between man and man and go right ahead. The Christian book talks some bullshit. I'll bring it up out the pages for you to see. So you can have all the freedoms that I have. You're just not ready to sacrifice all that the world offer you, right? You don't know what you're going to do, or I got to pay taxes. What's going to happen? I'm not going to have a job. So without that paperwork, you just turn into an evil person. Your character is different because the piece of paper, y'all don't understand the make-believe world. If you are going to have a piece of paper with your name on it, make sure it's one that you say who you are, like you. And why would you lie? And if somebody don't agree that you are who you say you are, they welcome to take you to court and prove otherwise on their dime because it's their charge. Henceforth, innocent until proven guilty. See, I tell people that I'm a lawyer and they think that it's an office, it's some clients. It's not. It's about justice. And I know how to get justice for me if one of y'all cross me. And by y'all, I mean anybody. Y'all mistake IRS for anything other than just words. See, it's human beings like me and you that work in there that come up with this scheme, but it's fraud to say since there's so many of us and we had this official stamping that you have to go along with it to exist. And I'm like, nope, I don't. Now show me why I do. And the IRS faded back like the cowards or the liars that they really are. Because in real time, if you challenge, it's different. It's different. People don't beat the feds. The feds win 85% of the time because 85% of the time, people don't challenge them on law. The feds will never win with me. Like, it's Constitution. You can't call yourself the feds and then not use the Constitution. It's federal. They're supposed to protect it. So I'll carry a gun if I want. I'll use any substance that I want to put in my body. You can't stop my life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. If I want to use cocaine, I'll use it. Constitutional use of cocaine. And I'm not asking. The Constitution of the United States of America is that Constitution. It's one nation under God. And y'all motherfuckers be on so many frauds, but y'all won't use God as a fraud to keep the freedom that your creator gave you. That's the part that I don't get about you blacks. And y'all so close to the book, shucking and jiving every weekend, church giving out all this money, old ladies with the big hats and shit, like Easter parades, you motherfuckers. And then when it come down to actually knowing, oh, they didn't know any better. Well, when's somebody going to teach them any better? Okay, I got information. How long I've been on the job? Since about 2017, 2018. I've been since then. I got 990-something followers. Blacks don't want to listen. The bulk of the people that listen to me are descendants from other countries. I don't want to say they're Americans, but not these Negroes or brown people. The information who, for the people that's the most oppressed, should seem like they should be in it the most, but people have tricked them. They didn't know. Nobody knows because this is secret information to keep the black man down because this special society is set up to Thomas Sowell, y'all. The Origins of Woke by Uncle Thomas Sowell. Hope the volume is good, folks.
The vision of the anointed. Now, that's a That's an interesting title. Who are the anointed?
They're the elite in the media and in politics. All of those who think that third parties ought to be making people's decisions for them. The subtitle is self-congratulation as a basis for social policy. In other words, people who think that everything that's wrong with the country is due to the fact that other people are just not as smart as they are. And if only they could, you know, or people like them could take over and make our decisions, we'd be so much better off.
But in the early, in early America, didn't this sort of educated class make the decisions for everybody?
As far as governmental decisions, yeah. But the government itself didn't make the decisions for everyone. Uh-huh. Now, you can't decide where your kid's going to school. You can't decide whether or not they can move a halfway house for drug users next door to you or whatnot.
It's out of your control. The government decides.
That's right. The government decides too many things. They decide also how your children will be raised. You may have an idea about what age children should be introduced to sex and in what manner, with what kind of moral commitment.
You mean as a parent?
As a parent, yes. The schools have taken that over. By the time you even think about it, they've already had years, you know, showing...
They're passing out condoms to these kids.
Passing out condoms is not even a half of it. They're showing motion pictures of naked couples engaging in sex, both homosexual and heterosexual, in the seventh grade. And if you complain about it, that's considered to be censorship.
You don't, you can't pull your kid out of school and say they don't have to put up with this stuff? I guess you could, but you'd be...
Well, if you have a private school to put in, but you have compulsory attendance laws, and if you don't have the money for private schools, then you're stuck.
Where did this country get off the track and decide that the federal government should make most of our decisions?
Well, it started to some extent in the New Deal, but I think the 1960s is sort of the golden age, if you want to put it that way, of this whole mindset. And that's what the book's about. It's about a mindset. It's not about a series of policies. But of showing how in policy after policy, those who think a certain way will try to take over other people's decisions.
How do you characterize the liberal philosophy today from the conservative philosophy?
Well, that's a tough one. I guess the main thing about the liberals, again, is that they think a program will do it. If there's something that they don't like in the society, you got to set up a program and not just solve the problem. I think one of the words they use a lot is solutions. And I argue here and elsewhere that there are no solutions. There are just trade-offs. So, for example, when Ralph Nader launched his attack against the Corvair many years ago,
the car
is an unsafe car, and it has these safety problems and those safety problems. And in some respects, he was correct, not all. But the fact is, there were other things that the Corvair would do that made it safer than other cars. And on net balance, it was as safe as the rest of them.
Are you saying there are no solutions to our problems as Americans?
There are no solutions to anybody's problems. There are trade-offs. You know. Safety is a classic example. Every year, so many hundreds of thousands of people are vaccinated against measles, smallpox, those kinds of things. Now, this saves and that's several hundred lives, that it's estimated. It also causes brain damage to about 30 kids a year. Now, there are no solutions to that. There are just trade-offs.
What about crime? Take crime as an issue. Can we solve the crime issue or fundamentally solve it so it's reduced?
Well, then that's a trade-off. You don't solve it. There will always be crime. There always has been. But you want to keep it down to some level. It's not this astronomical thing we have today. For example, the liberals right now are saying, you know, crime has eased off in New York. And that's true. There were six times as much crime in New York a few years ago as there was in 1960. Now it's down to five times as much crime as there was in 1960.
See how it worked.
Now that's not what I regard as a great trend, unless it continues a lot more strong.
Well, liberals think we need more education and we need to help people in the inner city more to cut down crime there. Conservatives would say we have to be tougher on crime. Is either of them correct?
You see, the conservative view is really not a solution. It's a trade-off. It says, yes, it would be wonderful if we could do all these things to prevent crime in the first place. We just don't happen to be that smart. And so what we do, we put people behind bars who commit violent crime. Now, a few years ago, in East Palo Alto, which is not far from Stanford University, minority community, low income, they had the doubtful distinction of being the murder capital of the United States in proportion to their population. The next year, murder and all sorts of other violent crimes dropped a tremendous amount, 30, 40, 50% in 1 year. Now, that wasn't because they discovered the root causes of crime or because they worked out everything was wonderful. They launched a campaign that put a lot of the bad guys behind bars. And when they were behind bars, they didn't commit as many crimes.
Makes sense to me.
And the thing that this is, you know, even in a high crime area, the great majority of the people are not criminals. And so if you can just put your hands on those people who are raising all the hell in the community and take them out of circulation, the crime rate drops.
People say there's undue emphasis on African Americans for committing crimes. Is that true? I wrote a column here that the population is 25% African American in New York. 62% of the crimes are committed by African Americans.
I haven't checked this for years, but throughout the world, this is not unusual. Throughout the world, people are disproportionately represented in all kinds of different things. And it's true, obviously, in basketball. It's true in all kinds of other things. The main thing is not to keep people out of jail because they're one race or another. Because when you do that, the people who are going to suffer the most will be the black community.
Where are you on affirmative action?
Again.
Why?
Well, you can only do one of two things. You can either judge people individually or you can judge them by groups. This whole notion that you're going to come out with a compromise, I would defy anybody to come out with a compromise on that. You're going to do one of those two things. Now, you can pretend to be doing other things, but that's all you're going to do. Those are the only two choices you really have in the end. Again, the people who are the anointed, think of this as a symbolic issue, and they want to be on the side of the angels. They don't ask, what are the consequences? Now, I've studied affirmative action programs around the world. One of the consequences is that those people who are more fortunate in the group that has the preferences, those people take the lion's share of the preferences. Very often, those at the other end of the scale, poorer people, actually fall further behind. It's true of blacks here, it's true of Malays in Malaysia, it's true of various groups in India. And there are reasons for that. You can say you must have certain proportion. Nothing is easier than for an employer who might otherwise locate, let's say, in the Bronx, to locate out in Provo, Utah, where he will be not near any black people, and therefore he will never have lawsuits, and the jobs will be in Provo, and people will wonder, why don't people, here have more jobs? It never seems to occur to liberals that other people are not blocks of wood, that when you set up certain incentives, they will react to them in certain ways. And when they do that, the result may be the opposite of what you set out to do.
How do the anointed refer to people they don't agree with?
All sorts of ways. But I think the main thing is they believe that you're not merely in error, but in sin. In other words, they can't believe that you're just mistaken. You must have sold out. You must have must be something warped about you.
You guys are for the rich. You guys only care about the rich guys. Answer that. How do you respond? Liberal says conservatives only care about rich people.
Well, one of the things I go into in the book is that the whole notion of rich is ridiculous. That most Americans don't stay in the same income bracket, even for one decade. So the same guy who is, quote, rich now was 20 years ago probably in the bottom 20%. I mean, I was on a cruise recently, a luxury cruise, and the guy said, if somebody had told me when I was growing up that I would end up on a cruise like this, I would have said, get real, man. That very few people are in that same income bracket. Right. The genuinely rich and the genuinely poor, I would estimate to be no more than 3% of the American people.
Really?
Put together.
Really?
Yes.
Genuinely poor. Now, I'm seeing numbers like when they were talking about health care, they said, 30 million people couldn't afford it or something?
Several million of those were making more than $50,000 a year. So it's not. See, this is one of the things the anointed do. They never believe that people make choices. There are people who have the money. They prefer to put that money into a BMW rather than
a lot of young people didn't want health care. They were betting on their health.
Absolutely. And then this allows them to buy more stuff that they want to buy. So it's not a question they couldn't afford it. It's a question they don't choose to spend.
Perspective.
What about mean-spirited? Conservatives are mean-spirited. They're bigots. They don't like people.
Well, one of the things I tell people say, you're a very tough person. I'm not tough. Life is tough. I'm merely trying to acquaint you with those facts.
Back in the 60s, Lyndon Johnson announced a war on poverty.
Mm.
Am I wrong? But there are more poor people. I mean, in other words...
Today than there were then, yes.
Yeah, there are more poor people.
Yes.
I mean, this was a hell of a war. We lost it, apparently, because for the last 30 years, we've been dumping money into these poverty programs.
Oh, absolutely.
Yes. Where's the money go?
Oh, it supports a whole industry of people who run those programs, who talk about those programs, research those programs, bureaucrats, and so on.
Doesn't help poor people.
No. The tragedy, you see, is that the anointed really want to make symbolic statements. And running these programs makes those symbolic statements. They don't really care if, in the wake of affirmative action, for example, companies start locating away from minority communities so they don't get involved in legal action. They don't care about that. They've made their statement on the side of the angels, and that's what's important.
Have you ever debated Jesse Jackson?
No, I haven't.
Is that because, would you like to, or would he not want to do that?
I have no idea. I have no idea.
You'd be willing to, I assume.
Oh, maybe. I don't know.
You think that's too much showbiz?
It is. There are people who go out to do this, and I'm doing less and less of it. I tell them the story of an African boxing champion who fought an Irishman in St. Patrick's Day in Dublin. And he lost his title on what the sports writers called a questionable decision. And so you have to know what forum you're talking about.
Right.
I saw Shelby Steele on with him, and I said, you know, if Jesse Jackson and Shelby Steele each had to present a two-hour lecture to an audience with an average IQ of 120, Shelby would wipe him out. But if they had 5 seconds each on Donahue, it would be Jesse Jackson all the way.
Right.
So everything depends upon the forum.
Is Jesse Jackson good for African Americans or
no,
not?
He's good for himself.
Good for himself.
And that's true of most ethnic leaders in most groups, in most countries, in most periods of history. That what will serve his interest is to keep people paranoid, dependent upon him, dependent upon government. What will serve their interest is typically just the opposite.
No leaders, y'all.
That's pretty interesting. So you're saying that the leaders, whatever group,
yeah,
whatever
yeah.
Leader, wants the people to be poor and dependent on them as opposed to dependent on themselves.
Oh, absolutely. And I you see this in the greatest cynicism in the academic world, where in many places, black organizations on campus have a say on who gets admitted. And they have turned down blacks with excellent credentials, both as students and as faculty members, for that very reason.
Who are the mascots of the Anointed? You talk about the mascots of the Anointed.
They're people whom they choose to back and whose rights are supposed to override other people's rights. The homeless are a classic example. I'm appalled when I see people out there in the streets giving money to the home. I mean, able-bodied men.
Yeah.
I mean, one of the classic pictures to me was in San Francisco when there was this able-bodied white man out in the street begging, and there's this black lady coming along there, very modestly dressed, like she didn't have, but she's stopping to open her purse to give him some money, you know. I thought, good heavens, have we really come to this? And we've been brainwashed by the Anointed into thinking this is what we ought to do.
What do you say to guys who bum money off of you?
Not all of it can be repeated on the air. But the fact is, they don't get any money.
They don't.
And people who complain now about all these people begging in the street, there's a simple answer. Don't give them money, and they won't be in the street.
When you wrote this...
Checkers.
What were you trying to accomplish with the book, and did you do it? Were you nailing liberals for 30 years of social policy? What were you trying to say?
I was trying to reveal the thinking behind that, the kinds of assumptions, the kind of world that exists inside their mind,
mm-hmm.
and therefore why those assumptions are so dangerous in the long run. It's not just the policies mentioned in those in that
They book. Think they're better than everybody else.
Oh, absolutely. There's no question. And that's what makes them dangerous. Even all the policies that are mentioned there, 20 years from now, those policies may not be the policies we're concerned about. But that mindset will still be there. And what makes them tremendously dangerous is that facts that contradict what they believe are simply ignored or evaded.
Where does the press fall into this as the Anointed Group? Are they part of the Anointed?
Oh, absolutely. They're a major part of it, because one of the reasons that people don't get many of the facts that go against what's believed is that the press doesn't choose to publicize those facts.
Give me an example of something the press might not cover or cover well.
Oh, a few years ago, there was a story about prenatal care among blacks, that black women get less prenatal care than white women. Infant mortality rate is higher among the blacks. They immediately assume that one causes the other. Now, one of the things I like to do is go back to the original source and find out what it said. I went back. On the very same page where it said that, the figures showed Mexican Americans get even less prenatal care than blacks, and they have a lower infant mortality rate than whites. So prenatal care and infant mortality rate have nothing to do with each other. You break it down further, black women who have only a high school education, but who are married, their children have lower infant mortality rates than white women who have a college education who are unwed mothers. So it's not race, it's not income, it's not education, it's lifestyle. When you live a certain way, there are consequences to that. The media doesn't want to accept that.
Alhamdulillah.
Lifestyles have a lot to do
with Islam.
Then there's no room for the Anointed.
And that's it, y'all. Thomas Sowell, the origins of woke. I don't want to talk through. There was a couple points I could have made, but that's what I've been saying before I connected with this elder. And I've been hitting these points off of just being accountable, being responsible, living an Islamic lifestyle, which is not by any stretch of the imagination, limited to the term Muslim. That's just the term to say, describe your relationship with Allah. I don't need that term. You know, you understand who I am by the way I move and that order that I follow. I'm not bowing down to anything that a man made. It's just past who I am right now. Like, I can't, and some people have to at this point. And that's fine, I get that part, but that's not gonna help you out, me getting where you are. What's gonna help you out is you getting where I am or what I'm talking about. And not about money, not about pride, and your understanding of what's real. And you're not going to get that from chasing a dollar. You're not going to get that from your state. You're not going to get that from anywhere. You're going to get that understanding from inside. What was given to you, which was been from the beginning, kind of pulled and misguided to the point where you became that. You start pulling and misguiding people in different directions. Classic excuse for black people. We didn't know. Well, here's Thomas Sowell. Here's Thomas Sowell. Right now, he's an elder. I guess him and Malcolm would be around the same age right about now, right? So he was around back then. And before I get off here, it'd be disrespectful if I didn't play the elder Malcolm X to let you know from the 60s. 2 years before I was born, he had these speeches, and I love playing them because it holds blacks accountable. It's going to be three of them that I'm going to play, y'all. Then I'm going to get out of here. We have 41 minutes. It's 6:15. Got to make much her. Her breakfast this morning, the kitchen is open today, y'all. Y'all know I got culinary skills and make you feel good to cook breakfast. Not necessarily breakfast, but to the person in your life to do something that's meaningful without it being braggadocious, with it coming from a good place, you know what I'm saying? And that's life. It's not Du Bois, it's not us on the ocean, all that shit. That's for y'all. That look good to y'all. I feel good inside. I'm going to make this breakfast. And I was sharing that to share, like not to brag. And some people are taking it for bragging. And that's just y'all nature because it's who y'all are. And the closer I get to Allah, the more revelation or revealing that you see with other people. And I accept it. You know, it's going to be people that it's not going to be in my life because I'm no longer compromising. Y'all got a lot of belief systems, and I charge and challenge y'all with all that shit, and it's a bunch of excuses. So, blacks don't know better. This old retarded ass American that's not black thought that these are the things that are best for Americans. I'm like, that's the America that you can have, and you welcome to it. But don't expect me to pony up and pay into something that's important to you in America, because that's not what America was founded on. It was founded on everything, not your thing. So here goes another person that I consider elder that's no longer around and had information that was pertinent and that you should have picked up on from 65, refined it, and put it into effect, but you haven't. But the same excuses you still have.
Just coming here proves Others came here as immigrants, uneducated, poverty-stricken. And their parents were able to open up stores, little stores. They lived in the back, sent their children to school. Their children studied business and came back and expanded the businesses. And most businesses in the white community today are called so-and-so brothers, so-and-so and son, and so forth. This is how you establish what you call the American economy, somewhat speaking on the run. Negroes have been here free since 1865, so-called, have a purchasing power of $20 billion per year, have more education than any group, any minority group on this earth. You can't go in the Negro community anywhere in the Bay Area and find five businesses owned by Negroes, so-and-so and son, or so-and-so brothers. The mistake that we made differs from the mistake you didn't make. Your parents solve your problems economically, of their own volition, with their own ingenuity. Our leaders have done nothing to teach us how to spur business. They've done nothing to teach us how to elevate the level of our schools. They've done nothing to teach us how to keep up the standard of our community. It is not the masses of black people who are at fault for this. It's this Negro puppet that the white liberal has set over the Negro community to act as our leader and act as our spokesman, who have failed to show us how to solve our own problems, so we remain crippled.
Religious leader teaches us the importance of doing something for ourselves now, rather than trying to continue to force ourselves into the white community or upon the white man. He teaches us that if we would do something for ourselves, clean up ourselves, morally, intellectually, and otherwise, and then try and do something for ourselves economically, we would be recognized and accepted by others. But as long as we try and force ourselves in upon others now without having done nothing to prove that we are on any kind of equal basis with them, there will always be this race tension and race problem.
When you say force yourselves upon others, upon the white community, how exactly do you mean that?
Well, any form of integration, forced integration, any effort to force integration upon whites is actually hypocritical. It is a form of hypocrisy.
Affirmative action.
If
Saul was against it. Malcolm X.
Pass laws to force whites to pretend that they want Negroes into their schools or in their places of employment. Well, this is hypocrisy, and this makes a worse relationship between black and white, rather than if this could be brought about on a voluntary basis. So the Honorable Elijah Muhammad says that what should happen is the black man himself should learn how to develop himself in the same sense that the white man has developed himself, then they can both come together and recognize each other as equals.
These are puppets that have been put in front of the Negro community by white liberals. These are parrots that have been put in front of the Negro community by white liberals. You can't name me a Negro leader who has been betrayed Negroes, who has not been endorsed, sanctioned, subsidized, and supported by the white liberals.
In this crooked game of power politics here in America, the Negro, namely the race problem, integration, civil rights issue, are all nothing but tools used by the whites who call themselves liberals against another group of whites who call themselves conservatives, either to get into power or to retain power. Among whites here in America, the political teams are no longer divided into Democrats and Republicans. The whites who are now struggling for control of the American political throne are divided into liberal and conservative kings. The white liberals from both parties cross party lines to work together toward the same goal.
It's in the 60s, y'all.
And white conservatives from both parties do likewise.
Y'all ain't know?
The white liberal differs from the white conservative only in one way. The liberal is more deceitful, more hypocritical than the conservative. Both want power, but the white liberal is the one who has perfected the art of posing as the Negro's friend and benefactor. And by winning the friendship and support of the Negro, the white liberal is able to to use the Negro as a pawn or a weapon.
Still doing
this political football game.
Still doing
it. Constantly raging between the white liberals and the white conservatives.
You are a weapon.
The American Negro is nothing but a political football. And the white liberals control this ball through tricks or tokenism, false promises of integration and civil rights. In this game of deceiving and using the American Negro, the white liberals have complete cooperation of the Negro civil rights leader, who sell our people out for a few crumbs of token recognition, token gains, token progress. In the New York Tribune, in an editorial dated February the 5th, 1960, they pointed out that out of 11 million qualified Negro voters, only 2,700,000 actually take time to vote. This means that, roughly speaking, only 3 million out of the 11 million Negroes who are qualified to vote take an active part. And the remaining 8.
I'm gonna cut him off right there. Information from the older mouth, mom. For all the blacks that was tricked, your grandmother and them that didn't know it. Why does Malcolm know this? You know what I mean? Like, how does he know this stuff? Anybody? One more thing from Malcolm. It's like 9 minutes long. I'm at 51 minutes in. That should put me right at an hour, y'all. Not too long. Didn't monopolize all y'all time this morning. And shout out to my neighbor. We talked. It was a nice conversation I had with him. First time we actually had an extensive conversation. I knew his kids, his kids, his wife. They're all good people. We never really had a chance to talk, and it was nice talking to him. And in our first conversation, and he's a what y'all would call a Caucasian American, but nah, he's not. I believe his wife teaches Hebrew. I want to say they're Jewish, but not in the sense of the ethnic. They're good people. I don't want to even put that on him. But we spoke, and he was like, "Hey, you should send your stuff to Ben Shapiro." And y'all know I'm rough around the edges with how I present stuff. And I like Shapiro. I like Shapiro, Candace Owens, that whole. Shapiro is brilliant. I think that the Jewish part, y'all know where I sit at with these labels. Even that, like, you don't have to be a Jew, a Semite. I've done, and I know Shapiro is smart. I know he has to have as much research done as I had done the rabbinical stuff. So I know to a certain degree he's playing a role as well. He's just further along, truer than the rest of the stuff. But with the Jew stuff right there, and I have to mention that too, because my loyalty is to the creator, not to any man. So yeah, I can go to war with Shapiro, but I also know where he is. So my neighbor was, this is the first time anybody said that. He's like, these other platforms or whatever, they'll never hear a voice like yours. And this was in light of the normal conversation, stuff like I'm saying right now. And I explained, y'all know I'm truthful to who I am. I'm an ass. I'm not really nice or whatever. But right now, that's what's going to have to be heard with the truth, a heavy dose of the truth, with being unapologetic about how it's delivered. And I don't care if people get offended now, because I'm offended. I'm offended that this world, this is where we all pretend that they keep the order of God and then give you the order of man and then try to galvanize it with shame, with force. And I'm at a place where I'm like, fuck all of that. And you've seen the success that I had by standing under order our creator. So all these audio links, these things that I'm playing that support absolutely what I'm saying, it's not to prove shit to any of these fucking creeps, except you're lying. To the people that do see, y'all have something to compare this shit against. These fucks, I don't care about them. Like, you hear what the elder said? If you arrest the bad people, the crime will go down. It's true. But the mentality, the system will stay the same because those people are in charge of it. That mentality will make the crime reappear again. You get rid of this mind state, and that the physical part will turn into that. It's like you have a mind to work out every day. Watch what happened to your body as opposed to not working out every day. Is that real? Y'all needed to be chess because you're lazy. You don't want the hands-on. Is this or is that? That neighbor Joe, that was so concerned about stuff that wasn't where he was at. When I got in his face and said, if I attack you right now, what are you going to do? And he was old and feeble, but you should saw the reality on his face. Like, yeah, don't talk in theory. That's bullshit. Your theory going to fuck somebody's life up, old man. When I put it in real time that he could get fucked up, he got it. You could see his gears turning. You know what I'm saying? And that's how I talk. It's just saying you're not going to get away with, I'm not going to allow you to get away with fuckery, especially when I can see his fuckery. With Joe, when it was for Joe, he was interested in male. I don't give a fuck what his thing is. That's his thing. And I could break the male thing down, but that's feminine. Oh, yeah, well, I don't get male. I'm good without male. And I don't. That's the fact. But I'm not arguing that with Joe. Fuck Joe. I don't pay taxes because Joe want male. Joe can go fuck himself. Joe telling me I can go fuck myself because I need to pay so he can get mail. Oh, he likes roads, so he want roads paved. That's not enough for me. Like, roads paved to keep all your money. I think most people say, fuck them roads. Or where they was at, they make it a little comfortable for themselves. Maybe some boards. And I guarantee you, the neighborhood would get together and do it. I grew up in Park Heights, the hood, and I don't want to say it's the late 70s. We had this fucking blizzard that had the street shut down. You know, every neighbor in this black neighborhood came out and dug out and met each other and cleared our streets. Keith Pulliam, Ricky, Wayne, all these people, they should know. This is the truth. If y'all hear this, you from Oakley Avenue, drop a comment and tell me you remember that. We dug out because we needed to dig out. Now, imagine streets needing to be made. We had kids, the baby boomers. Everything was about the kids, right? I don't know what the fuck happened. The 60s is where shit went fucking crazy. In the 60s is where blacks lost their mind. They said it was with welfare, whatever. Black Americans, y'all had this movement that was about being equal. Wasn't about being black. When it turned to black, that's when it went to shit. As long as it was about equity and equality, it was good. When y'all put that color on that shit, that's when y'all fucked it up. That's when it could be bought and paid for, right? That's what this elder Malcolm is talking about. That's one of the things that I did know myself. The Big Six. Any of y'all familiar with them? Civil rights activists. Check on the Big Six. One of those guys, John Trouble Lewis, I think that's his name, just passed away. He's a part of it. All these different groups. So, and I think the biggest problem that Malcolm had was his hatred for white people. Like, that thing for all whites because of what certain evil, what he called whites. And I'm working on that too because I'm steeped in years going black and white. So, excuse me. Sometimes if I say white, if I say black, I'm training myself to stay away from it because it's important. It's not for vanity, simple vanity. Just get the proper thing, like saying travel instead of drive. It has to become reality. As real as you say drive, you need to practice saying travel. It's the difference in killing and murder. You know, people are messed up with the word because they insert kill and murder and think it's interchangeable, but there's no laws against killing. God instructed people to go out and kill, but it was in war. You know, it wasn't just give me your money or I'm a murder. You know, that's not an order of God. Like, murder is no reason, no combat, just out there. And y'all don't get that. You wanna say you don't know and you don't want to know. Like, this is information, but I guarantee blacks won't take it. It'll be like, oh, yeah, I knew that. But then don't apply it and then blame everybody and say, well, we didn't know. Nobody told us. Who's supposed to tell you how to be a man? Anybody that's got kids, who taught you how to fuck? It was important that you learn how to get some pussy, wasn't it? But the rest of the stuff not important enough for you to dig in. And when you find somebody that's as important enough to you who have never turned one page over in law, anything gonna tell me or debate me. Get my comments, ridicule and make fun of me for driving without a license. Where's those people at now? Like all of y'all, nobody's gonna come forth. I guarantee that. It's gonna be some more nigga shit, try to sidebar it or deflect. You can deflect me and it's no problem for your life, but you can't deflect what I'm talking about and it not be a problem in your life. That's why y'all live the way you live now. because you're not listening. You rather attack the person that's telling y'all fucked up than go attack the person that's actually fucking you up. Here's the Elder Malcolm again. Thomas Sowell spoke against organizations. Another elder that's older than most of us that's alive today that got it. So this thing about us being tricked, man, stop it.
Struggle in America reached its low point. King became bankrupt almost as a leader. Plus, even financially, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference was in financial trouble. Plus, it was in trouble, period, with the people when they failed to desegregate Albany, Georgia. Other Negro civil rights leaders of so-called national stature
making more coffee
became fallen idols. As they became fallen idols, began to lose their prestige and influence, local Negro leaders began to stir up the masses. In Cambridge, Maryland, Gloria Richard. In Danville, Virginia, in other parts of the country, local leaders began to stir up our people at the grassroots level. This was never done by these Negroes whom you recognize on national stage. They controlled you, but they never incited you or excited you. They controlled you. They contained you. They kept you on the plantation. As soon as King failed in Birmingham, Negroes took to the streets. King got out and went out to California to a big rally and raised about, I don't know how many thousands of dollars. Come to Detroit and had a march and raised some more thousands of dollars. And recall, right after that, Wilkins attacked King. Accused King in the court of starting trouble everywhere and then making the NAACP get him out of jail and spend a lot of money. Many accused King in court of raising all the money and not being back. This happened. I got it in documented evidence in the newspaper. Roy started attacking King, and King started attacking Roy, and Farmer started attacking both of them. And as these Negroes of national stature begin to attack each other, they begin to lose their control of the Negro masses. And Negroes was out there in the streets. They was talking about, we're going to march on Washington. By the way, right at that time, Birmingham had exploded, and the Negroes in Birmingham, remember, they also exploded. They began to stab the crackers in the back and buzz them upside the head. Yes, they did. That's when Kennedy sent in the troops down in Birmingham. So, and right after that, Kennedy got on the television and said, there's a moral issue. But that's when he said he's going to put out a civil rights bill.
Oh.
And when he mentioned the civil rights bill and the Southern crackers started talking about they were going to boycott it or filibuster, then the Negroes started talking about what? We're going to march on Washington, march on the Senate, march on the White House, march on the Congress, and tie it up, bring it to a halt. Don't let the government proceed. They even said they were going to go out to the airport and lay down on the railway and don't let no airplanes land. I'm telling you what they said. That was revolution. That was revolution. That was the Black Revolution. It was the grassroots out there in the street. Scared the white man to death. Scared the white power structure in Washington, D.C. I was there. When they found out that this Black steamroller was going to come down on the Capitol, they called in Wilkins. They called in Randolph. They called in these national Negro leaders that you respect and told them, call it off. Kennedy said, look, y'all letting this thing go too far. And old Tom said, boss, I can't stop it because I didn't stop it. They said, I'm not even in it, much less at the head of it. They said, these Negroes are doing things on their own.
Bad game, bro.
They're at the head of us. And that old said, well, if you all aren't in it, I'll put you in it.
There it is.
I'll put you at the head of it. I'll endorse it. I'll welcome it. I'll help it. I'll join it. The very, a matter of hours went by.
Shout out to the Elder Malcolm.
We had a meeting at the Carlisle Hotel in New York City. The Carlisle Hotel is owned by the Kennedy family. That's the hotel Kennedy spent the night at two nights ago. Belongs to his family. A philanthropic society headed by a white man named Stephen Currier.
Philanthropist.
All the top civil rights leaders together at the Carlisle Hotel. And told them that by you all fighting each other, you're destroying the civil rights movement. And since you're fighting over money from white liberals, let us set up what's known as the Council for United Civil Rights Leadership. Let's form this council. And all the civil rights organizations will belong to it. And we'll use it for fundraising purposes. Let me show you how tricky the white man is. And as soon as they got it formed, they elected Whitney Young as the chairman. And who do you think became the co-chairman? Stephen Currier, the white man. A millionaire. Powell was talking about it down at the Cobo today. This is what he was talking about. Powell knows it happened. Randolph knows it happened. Wilkins knows it happened. King knows it happened. Every one of that so-called Big Six. They know what happened.
Big Six, y'all.
Once they formed it with the white man over it, he promised them and gave them $800,000.
Money, y'all.
To split up between the Big Six. And told them that after the march was over, they'd give them $700,000 more.
Sellouts.
$1.5 million split up between leaders that you've been following, going to jail for, crying crocodile tears for, and they're nothing but Frank James and Jesse James and what you call it, brothers.
Younger brothers.
Soon as they got the setup organized, the white men made available to them top public relations experts. Opened the news media across the country at their disposal. And then they began to project these Big Six as the leaders of the march. Originally, they weren't even in the march. You were talking this march talk on Houston Street. Is Houston Street still here? But the white men put the Big Six ahead of them, made them the march. They became the march. They took it over. And the first move they made after they took it over, they invited Walter Luther, a white man. They invited a priest, a rabbi, and an old white preacher. Yes, an old white preacher. The same white element that put Kennedy in power. Labor, the Catholics, the Jews, and liberal Protestants. Same clique that put Kennedy in power joined the March on Washington.
Boom. It's not new. It's been around forever, right? So to all you black elders that you're not even elders, honestly, to all you older blacks. Like, stop making the fucking excuses, right? This is, Malcolm is obviously not with us anymore, but he was with us back then. Nobody listened. Thomas Sowell is still with us now. Nobody's listening. You might not think it's significant about the driver's license situation because it's easy to sit back on your ass in the house and try to downplay it. That's the easiest thing in the world. But my challenge is, you feel a way about it or me, do the shit that I did. And this is where I'm not polite. I'm not politically correct because I'm not a politician. I'm here to make a fucking point. So anything other than proving it is pointless, and not with talk, not with debate. Light the comments up. But y'all ain't gonna sit in front of that police. You're not going to have that driver's license situation, the taxes situation. You'll argue in theory about God. That's all Christians do, argue in theory. Men of God do shit. The country was founded by men that stood up. That's it. It wasn't white men. It was men that wanted to be free. And after those men passed, the tyranny's head raised again, and men haven't raised themselves up again since. But it's coming. Like, it has to be to the point of where it's so wicked that you don't have a choice but to stand up. And that's what it's come to. You know, for me, it's a choice. It's an honor to stand up. I love it. It's like to press the world, to show the world that you've been lying the whole time. And I started with something big, the government. When you engage that, the powers that be, and people don't get it, like, it ain't the powers that be. Powers only be because you allow it to be. So the 4th of July is a real independence celebration that meant something. Men stood up to fight. I don't give a fuck what color they was. It was some other men. And even more so, white men was fighting white men for their freedom. White men fought white men for their freedom. You had to kick out. Y'all know corner boys? Now, we ain't no corner boys no more. Fuck you. You know what the boss say? Oh, you don't leave this gang. You ever try to leave a gang? Well, how about the person that was leaving the gang whipped the gang's ass and got their freedom from the gang? How about that? That terms, blacks, how about it would be the equivalent of y'all rising up against the slave masters and freeing yourselves by force instead of they allowing you to be free and then you celebrating Juneteenth like it's monumental? Y'all play around, give your kids fucking false senses of victories. And your biggest victories are what? You slaves? You came from Africa? Oh, I got to do this for y'all real quick, too. To destroy some more nigga myths about you being from Africa. And it's going to be hard for blacks to get it. I'm going to play it. And then I'm going to explain it. And I'm going to explain why whites are superior to blacks, okay? And it's real simple, y'all. It's real simple. Extremely simple. This thing about Africa, the emotions that it pulls out of people, it allows you to be willfully stupid, right? So I talk about the doctrine of discovery a lot, which instituted slavery in the world. This is the thing that started this Christianity. I know I'm going on long, but it needs to be said, and it's a freestyle, and it is my channel, y'all. I get to put out any information I want. And that's what I wanted to have a channel for, so I appreciate everybody that come and take the information, but you know I could be long-winded. But it'll make sense in the end. So the documents of discovery, which we all know, anybody that's been following, was a decree from the Roman church to say, look, we better than everybody else, and if you're not Christian, we're going to take your shit. Documents of discovery. All right, Canary Islands, Portugal, and Spain, these two people were colonizing the world at a crazy rate. Spain is the initiator in this. So I'm going to run down this stuff, y'all. Y'all welcome to hang out a little bit longer. Come back later, go get some snacks. But the information will be here. And it all goes together. This is some of the stuff that is necessary, especially for blacks, to get out of this "you're from Africa" shit. This is a part of your ignorance. And again, y'all don't know, right? So here's me putting you in the know, but I guarantee you, nobody black will pass this shit on to anybody else black. Let's start with the documents of discovery.
Doctrine, the international law, doctrine of discovery. First, and this was primarily developed by the Catholic Church and by Spain and Portugal. Starting in the 1340s, primarily being solidified in 1436 when Pope Eugenius II issued, I believe, the first papal bull about actual colonization and European power outside of Europe, granted the Canary Islands to Portugal to control and convert the wild men, that's quote-unquote, the wild men of the Canary Islands. The Canary Island peoples were denigrated by the Spanish and the Portuguese. You can read the identical definitions of what were said about American Indians and the indigenous peoples around the rest of the world by why these Canary Island people have no law, they have no agriculture, they have no clothes, they have no money, they don't speak our language, they don't have laws.
That's what the Christians said.
The majority of those things were lies, weren't they? But those were the same kind of justifications conditions that have always been described about American Indians and indigenous peoples elsewhere. To lower, literally, folks, that's one of the elements of racism, of the definition of racism, is to somehow set yourself apart.
Classism.
And then to lower in your valuation the way they live.
Classism.
Or their law or their ethics. And that's exactly what the Spanish and the Portuguese were doing. Well, I'm going to need more than 30 minutes. I'm still on element one. This has always been used as justification for Europeans to cross the ocean, claim the whole world because their religion was better than ours and because their civilization was better than ours. I think the United States continues to use arguments like that today. Can you remember a decade ago when we invaded Iraq? Do you remember a lot of the language that was used that Christianity could be taken to the Middle East? And I don't think the United States used the word civilization, but we were going to take democracy to the Middle East. Those were literally those same two ideas, that the United States is superior and can take these ideas to the rest of the world.
Where we at, yo?
After fighting over the Canary Islands, and receiving that papal bull in 1436, Portugal continued to explore down the west coast of Africa.
Portugal.
And wanted the Pope to justify Portugal's claims
Portugal
in Africa.
Is in Africa.
So in 1453 and 1455, Pope Nicholas V issues new papal bulls, granting Portugal the rights to not to control, Christianize, and civilize these wild men of Africa, but also now to acquire sovereignty, jurisdiction
in Africa. In Africa. Portuguese is in Africa. Y'all got it?
And so when Columbus shows up at the court of Isabella and Ferdinand and says, I think I can go west, and I think I can find lands to the west, King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella sent Columbus forth under seven documents that you can still read today.
Columbus is going to the west. That's Spain. We in the west.
So I don't think I can find the quote. But they said they had sent him forth to seek and acquire new lands. And they promised him, and I can quote this, quote, we will make you the admiral over any lands you acquire for us.
So Columbus is moving out west, right? Let's hear more.
So what did we learn in school Columbus was doing? We were all taught he was headed west to find good spices and cinnamon and pepper and stuff, right? No. Well, he ultimately was hoping to get to China and the Japans, but he was primarily looking for new lands to the west to claim for Spain.
West.
So the moment Columbus lands on, Hispaniola in the Caribbean and a couple other islands, he rushes back to Europe. Spain goes to the new Pope, Pope Alexander VI, and says, okay, we found new lands that only have heathen, indigenous, wild men. Give us these lands like you have been doing for Portugal. So in 1493... Pope Alexander VI issues four papal bulls, and he divides the world on this dotted line that you see on the map.
This part.
This is a perfect example of the contiguity element of the Doctrine of Discovery. And the Pope granted to Spain all lands west of that line to control, civilize, Christianize, and to acquire sovereignty, jurisdiction, and title.
That's us. What's the significance of this in the African slave trade? Anybody? If Portuguese is giving one side, the Eastern Hemisphere, to do the slave trade on, that's where Africa is. Portuguese and the Spanish can't cross lines or it'll be a war. The Pope is the medium between these Christian nations so that war don't break out. So Columbus, like, look, we can find land over here so it'll be no block war. You know, the Bloods and the Crips. Crips out west, blood out east. You know what I'm saying? So, or vice versa. So the slave trade from Africa, it did not happen. And another thing, the people that were here were the ones that were made slaves. they didn't need to bring anybody if you already had the word to just enslave them. Blacks, y'all talk sand to the beach, sand to the beach, sand to the beach, sand to the beach. Do you know what that's like in actual time? That would be to bring slaves to a landmass where they didn't know shit about cultivating it. When you take over a land, you take over the people that's there because they already familiar with how to get the most out of it. You don't bring another indigenous group of people from somewhere that's used to cultivating one kind of critical thinking. What whites have over blacks, logic. What blacks have over whites, emotions. Emotions don't serve in law. Emotions may serve as an art or something else that's not official, something that you may enjoy but won't free you. You know what I'm saying? So it's not necessarily a mental thing. It's a practice thing. Blacks are used to being coddled and people telling them, oh, you're this or you're that. Or you're black, for instance. You can't get outside of black to be American. That's one of the biggest, easiest things to do. Y'all think that I'm just saying shit, but I showed you everything that I was saying in real time, and y'all keep saying you got tricked. Well, okay, so now the trick's up. What are y'all gonna do about it? Just keep saying, oh, I don't know what I'm talking about. And you can do that, or you can prove I don't know what I'm talking about.
And the Pope granted to Spain all lands west of that line
us
to control, civilize, Christianize, and to acquire sovereignty, jurisdiction, and title. And he granted Portugal all those same rights west of that, or east of that line, excuse me. If you know your world history pretty well, you know who did the first colonizing in Africa. You know who rounded Africa and did the first colonizing in India,
Portuguese,
and Japan and some of the islands in the Pacific. And you know, gosh, what language do we speak in South America, Central America?
Spanish.
Mexico,
Spanish. Spanish.
Spanish.
Spanish.
What?
So, the whole slave trade shit, bruh, it's just not real. You know what I'm saying? It's not real. It's a compassionate, emotional lie, as well as the Holocaust. It's another one of those things where these are the chosen ones. This is what Thomas Sowell was talking about. The enlightened ones pick this group and say, don't touch them, like the homeless, the Jews, the blacks, the lesbians. And I'm like, finger to all of you motherfuckers. See, this is one nation under God. That is the most special thing about America. It's under God. It's not under Christians. It's not under Muslims, Hebrews, Jews. None of y'all are special. The only reason you are special here is if you keep the word of our Creator. Now, I don't know what a libertarian is, but someone told me that I was a libertarian. I'm like, well, those terms of men will keep you inside of what men see you as, but you have to deal with me as Evan. My views aren't put inside of these boxes that men do. Once you do that, then you subject to a behavior. People think that they can treat you as that. I'm like, nah, I'm smoke or I'm water. That's what I'll be, you know, and either one of them will kill you. You know, you can't stop either one of them, or both of them can be quite enjoyable. Like, I'm about to smoke some grass, and swimming is great, but you need to have the respect to those things. You can't put them in a jar. You can, but you can't shape them. You can't tell them. You can't grab them. You know, you can't give them a form. You only thing you can do with smoke or water is try to trap it, you know? And it's going to leak out some form of what it is. It's going to get on your hands or your clothes. So you have to deal with me as is. You can't put anything on me. And I tell people that I keep the word of Allah. I'm Islamic, if you want to call me anything. But man will still put me in his box. He'll be like, oh, well, yeah, this. I'm like, no, I'm not that. I'm Evan. And they can't get it. They will keep, and that's oppression. Like, they don't get it. Even on, it's not murder. But that's the thing that supplements. That's the thing that makes this world go. Like, you don't have a say to who I am. I tell you who I am. If you can't receive it, that's your shortcoming. That's not mine. Who y'all are is exactly who I receive y'all for. I don't call anybody any of these terms. I look at you, either you're an asshole or something. These other terms don't apply. These are titles, and that's idolatry. This is how Allah works, the simplicity of Allah. Any wall y'all put up, I'll tear that shit down. I'm not going to let you hide behind a title other than man. You accountable to me as a man. not as a superstar, a motherfucker that's rich, a pretty boy, or whatever. You old as a man. That's where Allah keeps you at. Once you create a title for yourself, you develop a behavior that's accepted with that title. I don't accept any of that shit. You a man. That's what I accept. I accept man-like behavior. Who I call you out is less than being a man. And y'all know what a man is. You know, it ain't no this, that, or the third. You know, men ain't saying it because they being it. You know, and women can't tell you what a real man is. She gonna marry him. And she ain't gonna be on the social media saying what he is or what he not. That's a bitch, a single bitch. That's not a good woman, obviously, because she don't have a good man. But y'all so tricked, right? One more thing.
Great debate arose in Spain about the Doctrine of Discovery and the papal bulls and whether indigenous peoples were humans and whether they could own property and property rights.
I don't think I want to talk about that. That's all.
And I told you that Spain was the most legalistic of all the conquerors. There was no question of that.
Spain.
Because you can read the 1512 Laws of Burgos, B-U-R-G-O-S, which I believe is a city in Spain. They made the very next year, they drafted the Requerimiento in 1513, which required the conquistadores
the conquerors.
To read this document to indigenous peoples before they attacked them and killed them. And the Spanish conquistadors would read this document sometimes from the boat, and they'd read it to the land, or they'd read it into the beard, as the Spanish express, and they'd read it real quiet. And what the documents say? The Pope has given your lands to Spain. The Pope has appointed a new king for you, the Catholic king, or the Spanish king.
So while the premise, the colonization of America, was on Christianity, it's your job to insert the word of God, because they fucked up. That's dead. Like, they want to say a technicality, but no, it's one nation under God. And if you don't present God, then you get man. It's not tricks. It's not black. It's not white. It's ignorance. It's a willful ignorance. It's a lack of diligence to something, because everything you love, you put all your energy into. So you tell on yourself. You know, nobody else has to tell you anything. You are accountable for you. All the kids that you have, you size up your situation, your house, your finances. Or was it a night of passion? Or what was it? Because if you didn't have that child with a destination in mind, who you blaming? If you're not aware of everything that that child is going to need to know, who are you blaming? Whites don't blame blacks for their shortcomings. Asians don't. Latinos don't. And this is America. Nobody gives a fuck about anybody. If anybody black knew the real history of this place after that bullshit slavery, you know, like, that was one portion. And then this country came up and everybody was rich. No, they wasn't. The country wasn't founded on everybody being rich. The country was founded on everybody having a chance to have. That was it. Wasn't founded for white people, because there was no white people that came here. It was Europeans, Germans, French, English, Irish, Scottish, Dutch. They came here and they weren't all friendly with each other. So this white America, this white utopia that got put in black people's minds, that's more shit that comes from your own ignorance, your lack of being able to critically think that all people aren't one people. Y'all are simple fucks that want to overly simplify something like race and then complicate everything else and call it chess. This is your own mess. Islam.